Hey everybody, thanks for being here. This week, we're on the Willamette River at Oregon City, first for spring Chinook, and then we're on the same stretch of river for hard-fighting American Shad. If you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. We're targeting Spring Chinook with Procure Roe and Sand Shrimp, and we're with guide Dave Ng, along with Jason Handley, Devin Dobek, and Caden Miller.
We're starting here, launching at Meldrum Bar, and we're just going to be fishing a little 2 miles upriver here by Oregon City, maybe not even that far, half mile. One hole called the Garbage Hole, the other one's the Sandbar. They're 25 minutes from downtown Portland. It's a pretty good fishery. It's below the Willamette Falls. So the fish kind of keg up in this area, and hopefully we can find a few. Well, this is the Garbage Hole, and this is usually one of the holes that does the producing. So we'll probably start right here, make a pass or two here. We're gonna stick our bow rods out at 70 feet on the line counters, and the back rods we're gonna put out at 90. Normally I'd put the middle out at 90, but we only have three of us fishing. So typically I like them 20 feet apart on the spread. So 70, 90, 110. But we're gonna have a bouncer or two going, so we'll get started at 70 and 90.
So we got four rods out. We got four of them on divers, right? And we're, him and I are back bouncing. Just a different technique. Try to get them all bumped up, get them to bite.
Yeah, we've got six rods out because we got three guys fishing, and in on the Willamette this year, you can buy a second rod permit. So if my math is correct, 3 times 2 is 6.
So the current's pumping pretty good. I started out with 8 ounces and I was walking away the heck back. So I'm gonna step up to 10 ounces and see if that slows it up a little bit.
The river's really screaming this year because of all the snowpack and the rain and everything. So we're fighting kind of high water conditions, but it's making it really good as far as keeping the temperatures down. So it should play in our advantage. It's got us in less places to fish, because some of it's just obviously way too fast. So, you know, you deal with what the cards are dealt you, but I think it's gonna hold up a heck of a lot longer than it normally does. Eggs usually start slowing down at 50 or 60 degrees is what we've all been told. I don't know that I buy that 100%, but there's pretty good chances to fish this all the way into mid-June at this year, because we are at 52 degrees right now.
I don't think so. Oh, yeah, he's there. This is hopefully a spring Chinook on a diver and eggs and sand shrimp. Get on the other side of here.
Todd, you're driving.
Looks
like a good one.
Looks like a nice master.
Yes, sir.
Keep one of those.
Keeper.
Probably either a Sandy M hatchery fish or a McKenzie. And it's a nice, big, bright, solid fish. Those are actually Procure Fuse eggs. Those are straight out of the jar fuse.
Nice purple back fish.
Beautiful.
So we've just seen a few fish caught here, and most of them have been on the west end side of the river. and that can change at any minute, but right now we're going right back to the spot where we got them, just here, what we call the garbage hole, and it's kind of right at the lip. So we're gonna keep doing what we're doing. That fish was on Procure Fuse straight out of the, you know, jar, nothing added to it with the sand shrimp. So we'll keep doing what we're doing and hope for number two.
Welcome back to the Willamette River. I'm Justin Wolf. We have our first spring Chinook in the boat, which came on a basic diver and bait setup.
So what we're running out here today, fishing with Dave, is he's got a jumbo jet diver. This is the blue colored one. They make them in a variety of different colors. All of them serve the same purpose, but for some reason, blue seems to be one of the more successful colors.
Other than the fish was caught on chrome.
Yeah, generally. Got a B&R slider and a little dual lock snap. A little bit of a dropper there. It goes to a barrel swivel. Then he runs about 7 feet a leader. And about halfway down that leader run two big black corkies. And that helps float your bait up off the bottom because he is using a longer leader. So that with the gob eggs and a piece of sand shrimp, good to go.
You know, Oregon City, everybody's kind of a blue diver guy. I'm probably not as superstitious as most, but you know, pretty good fisherman like Terry Mulkey will tell you, any color will work as long as it's blue. But we did just catch that fish on a chrome jet diver. Sometimes my thinking is, you know, there's 10,000 of the same things out there. Maybe once in a while show them something a little tiny bit different, or a little bit different flavor bait, or you know, sometimes it's just a little bit of a mix-up. You know, I've noticed over the years fishing with guys like Jason that, you know, you're fishing a steelhead jig at 4 feet deep, and all of a sudden you're low, same spot, and you go through it 4.5 feet deep, and all of a sudden you catch a fish, you know. So it just mix things up a little bit, and when you got enough rods out like we do tonight, 6 rods, try something different, mix it up a little bit. The leaders we've got all pre-tied here on one of our leader boards, and just a great way to stay organized. You can actually use this white space if you want to write what poundage it is, but I just tied these up so I know they're all 25 pound, and they're just all ready to go. So when you've got a nick in your leader or got one busted off, pull it off and you're ready to go in the next minute or two. And they actually fit in these plain old boxes, so they're nice and secure and stay dry, so you don't take on any water, or stack them in your tackle box. They work real well.
Okay, so we have one rod up there at 70 feet, one here at 90. I'm gonna run this one clear back 110 feet, so just right over top of them. Best way is to put your front ones in first, and then you can float right over top of them. That in, let it free spool. Don't hold any pressure on it. It'll sink if you do. We're gonna be about underneath that guy's boat.
With the rod extensions, we have them set up with a straight inch in the back, 5 inch straight in the back, and that keeps that rod tucked in a little bit. You can see the next one, that one's an 8 inch bent, or I'll use my 12 inch bent in there, extreme. And then the very front, I use a 15 inch extreme going out, and that just keeps those rods staggered, you know, spaced out a little bit further as they get towards the front. So we're not just got all those baits in a line. They're actually coming down the river, you know, in a different path. Sometimes these fish are, you know, right next to each other or 4 feet off. So, and it keeps them from getting tangled. That's the biggest reason. You got them separated, and obviously the front one's in at 70 feet, 90 feet, and 110 feet. So they keep separated, and keep an eye on them when they're up elevated like that. I can see every rod tip from where I'm sitting. So the big tall one on my back is a 15 inch bent, and I use that there because I can see the rod tip. If Jason wasn't bouncing and I had another rod there, that rod tip will be up there where I can actually see it behind the big motor.
I was sitting there bouncing, it hit me in the back. That'll wake you up.
Wake up call.
Got this one on a diver and bait. I think this one had the Fuse salmon blend egg cure and a sand shrimp. Seem to work.
Yeah,
Yeah, we got pretty good, pretty darn good current, and it looks like a pretty decent fish. Looks like a real decent fish. And I'm out of rope here.
I'm not tired yet.
That is an absolute beast.
It's wild.
It is?
Yeah.
Yeah. Great big wild fish. We've got to release those, but fun for the ride. We're going shad fishing up here in Oregon City, kind of just right in the heart of Oregon City, just above the 205 bridge. And we're going to go up there and tow some mud bugs around with little flicker spinners and grubs on them, and see what we can come up with.
So Dave, you've been around a long time. Now, do you remember the first time the shad showed up here in the river?
Man, I don't. I do not.
That's because it was in the 1880s. You know, a lot of people, it's amazing how many people don't really don't know the history of shad, but they were first introduced to the Sacramento River in 1871, and by 1880, there was the first documented catching of an American shad in the Columbia River.
Really?
So you think you've been around a long time, but you really haven't. The shad have been here a lot longer than Dave Inc.
That's incredible.
So, yeah, but they did actually plant some shad in the Columbia River in the early 1870s. So, but anyway, it sure worked.
So, yeah.
And we got a lot of them.
Thank goodness. It's they're just a blast to fish for.
So we just went by about 100 or more boats that are anchored, but we're not doing that, right? We're up here above the bridge doing what now?
Right, we're going to be trolling for them, and you know, I prefer to kind of move around for two reasons. One, I'm not if you're in the right spot, anchor fishing is great, but if you're 10 feet off on these shad, you can struggle all day long until that guy moves, and then it's a drag race for his spot. Up here, we're moving around, and you know, we're going to troll around like we do with for salmon, just go find them. We just got a Brad's diver here, and it's just their standard diver, and then we got about 3-4 feet of 10-pound test line and a little spoon Dick Knight back behind it, and gonna run it out 70 feet on the back rods and 50 feet on the front rods and see if we can't figure out where these things are living today. The diver itself, you know, it's working the action of the lure back there as well. It's kind of darting all over the place, putting some wiggle on that, making it a little more attractive.
Is there any strategy to where you think the fish might be or where they're coming up the river?
Not necessarily here, because it's such a big area of water. The other day they were kind of tucked in close to this barge. We just basically did circles around the barge and caught fish most every pass. So, well, hopefully they'll do the same today.
It's gonna get it. That one's got it right there.
There's one. Back rod.
It's my rod with the Dick Knight. It's a silver and gold Dick Knight. It's a half and half, silver and gold, or a brass and silver. It's my favorite Dick Knight. Probably have 10 different colors, but I never seem to use the other colors because I always get bit on this gold or the gold and silver.
Okay, so check this shad out in the mouth. Or, you know, people say they have a paper thin mouth, but you can see how that hook is in the outside as he kind of swiped at it and then just barely caught it. So that's why I have a little bit of a limber rod, and you know, they're fun to catch because they are a little bit tricky to catch, but there's a lot of them and a lot of fun.
Well, there's just a whole ton of them right there on our TV or on our screen, and you know, see what happens when we drag these lures through them, and hopefully we get a rod to go down. On the corner! We've got that one on the corner, and that might have been because that dive rod dove a little bit different. That happens a lot when you're salmon fishing. You get one that, you know, that the speed changes on them, and we got Caden.
Oh, where's it? Came to the boat.
I'm like, anyway, we just lost that one, but the good news about shad is there's plenty of them.
People don't have to hire me, but if you want to just have some flat out fun, hire a guide and come out here and do this with your kids. You'll get them into fishing. You know, if there's so much action going on versus taking them salmon fishing where you might get, you know, 1 to 10 bites in a day. Out here, if it's on, you'll have 10 bites in the first half hour, you know, and the kids get all excited and want to do it. You know, a lot of guys poo-poo it because it's, you know, a shad, but it's a heck of a lot of fun and they're good fighters.
Welcome back to the Willamette River. I'm Justin Wolf. We're pulling small jigs with grub tails and small spoons for hard-fighting American shad, a transplant from the East Coast that has become a summer tradition on the West Coast. We're trolling with Brad's divers, which might be unusual, but definitely a fun way to catch shad.
It's a pretty good-sized male here. The females are usually quite a bit bigger. The other night we got another one right there. We got the net guy on the fish now. With females, you know, sometimes they'll run 3-4 pounds.
That's a bigger.
A big female?
Looks like it.
Yes, it does.
Okay, so let's just take a look at what Mr. Ng has here for shad. All right. Got some Gamagatsu hooks, that's always a good start. And see these little grub kits. Oh, no, yeah, well, these are Oregon tackle heads, okay. All right. And then some spoons, but
That's kind of the go-to starting lineup. I mean, you can see in here, we got, you know, an assortment of small spoons and, you know, the various colored jig heads, a few swivels. If I'm actually gonna go casting, I'll use one of those a little bit heavier to get down. But that's my whole kit. Very, very affordable to get into shad fishing. Oh, there's one.
So this is probably about our 10th hookup right here in the corner, this barge. So they definitely school in a certain area. And it's just a matter of finding the fish and trolling around like this, pretty effective.
Hey, Nick.
You know, we carry those grubs in the shop, you know, little teeny rounder heads, real small, maybe 16th ounce head, but I talk to people all the time come in that don't believe that they work for shad, you know, but they do, really. That's why I got them in the shop.
Yeah, these little grubs are just flipping deadly, you know, and you can mix them up and fish straight green or green and pink or straight pink, but they flat get it done.
So if you come in the shop, it's the Fishfield mini grub kit is what I carry. There you go, dude.
That's another grub. Coming right up the middle.
So here's the grubs using. Now this is probably a Fishfield grub, right? This is the same thing, I'm assuming.
Yes.
Yeah. Because I know Dave does business with Fishfield, so yeah. That's what we sell in the shop exactly, and it's perfect for shad.
Oh! I knocked that one off. Sorry.
So I don't see anybody casting from a boat. Like other rivers in the West have a lot of casting these jigs, so it's just not just because the water's not the, you know, too deep or too big.
I think there's just not enough current here to really play that game unless we cut the motor and just totally. You know, everybody casting and retrieving. So we're just trolling around making our own current. That's what makes these things dive. And we have what do we have here? We have a little smallmouth. He's on there.
Okay, Dave, I got the fish hawk here. So what's your prediction? How much cooler is it on the bottom than the top?
I'm going 3 degrees.
3 degrees. All right, gonna find out. Turn this baby on.
And
what we're gonna do is hit view at the surface, 68.1. 5 feet down, 67.4. 10 feet down, 67.1. 15, 66.9. And 20, 66.9. So not much of a difference at all because of the second largest waterfall in the United States about a quarter of a mile upstream from us, mixing the water probably.
That's pretty surprising that there's not any much difference in the temperatures. I would guess 3 to 5 degrees.
I've been finding that out. You know, the fishhawks gives you the whole different perspective on the fisheries. Like right below all the dams on the Columbia River, I've noticed, maybe not all, but you know, the dams that I've done this on, it's this way. There's you know, a total mixture of the water, and we're right below a big waterfall that mixes the water just like a dam does. So
be interesting to use that thing up behind my house on the Clackamas and find out, you know, surface temperature is 58 degrees right now. I'm wondering what it's down, you know, 12, 15 feet.
Well, I just put up a video about a week ago showing what it is in that the big salmon hole there. I think you know what I'm talking about. And at 20 feet, it was 3 degrees cooler than on the surface.
Okay.
So that would be normal here too if it wasn't for the waterfall. Hey everybody, thanks for watching today's episode. And be sure to stop by the Angler West store in Woodland, Washington. I'm sure we can help you catch more fish. And remember, without the sponsors, there is no show. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.